Muito boa tarde a todos, boa tarde ao Gunter Pauli por estar connosco aqui em Portugal. Não sei se é a primeira vez que vem a Portugal. First time?
Não.
Ah, já cá
esteve. Cinco ou seis vezes estava em Portugal.
E é sempre bem recebido, imagino, em Portugal.
Está a minha primeira vez em Estoril.
Bem, Gunter Pauli, como explicou a Clara, tem passado a sua vida a espalhar a palavra da economia azul, deste conceito que, no fundo, invadiu as vidas de muita gente em todo o mundo. E o que estamos aqui hoje a tentar, ou o que vamos tentar hoje, é responder a essa pergunta, o que é a economia azul? E não há uma única resposta para esta pergunta, porque a economia azul é um conceito inovador que não só pretende mudar mentalidades, como também pretende mudar o modelo com que nos relacionamos com o planeta. A economia azul é, por exemplo, transformar pedras em papel. Sim, isto é possível, funciona, sem recorrermos à água, sem recorrermos a árvores. A economia azul é, por exemplo, quando, na produção do café, em vez de deitarmos fora a grande parte que não usamos, a empresa, por exemplo, pode usá-la para cultivar cogumelos, pode usá-la para criar alimento para o gado e pode também convertê-la numa nova fonte de energia. A economia azul é, quando pensamos em substituir uma bateria por uma bateria verde, é mudarmos completamente o conceito, é pensarmos que, em vez de fazermos isso, vamos antes alterar todo o sistema de energia para que ele não necessite dessa bateria. E isso pode ser, por exemplo, usado nos telemóveis. A economia azul é fazer a barba com seda. É isso mesmo, fazer a barba com seda. A baba produzida por uma aranha, por uma espécie de aranha, tem a resistência e uma flexibilidade superiores à do aço. E isso pode ser aplicado nas lâminas de barbear. Estes são alguns casos concretos da economia azul que o Gunter Pauli tem estudado e tem espalhado, como dizia há pouco, pelo mundo, que pretendem, no fundo, menos investimento, mais inovação, mais emprego, empreendedorismo e novos modelos de negócio. A economia azul é centrada na ideia de que as empresas devem utilizar todos os recursos à sua volta e aumentar a eficiência para desenvolver um portfólio de negócios relacionados que vão beneficiar tanto às empresas como a todos nós como sociedade. O azul é a cor do mar. O azul é a cor do planeta visto do alto. O azul é o todo. E o que Pauli defende em termos industriais é que o azul representa uma eficiência da natureza, voltar à natureza. A natureza tem de nos inspirar mais a fazer diferente. O nosso corpo, como defende Gunter Pauli, cria vida e temos de gerar mais valor com o que está à nossa disposição. Gunter Pauli acredita que o melhor da globalização acabou, e de uma vez por todas, e que por isso temos de mudar as regras do jogo. Chegou à altura. O biodegradável, por exemplo, já não é sustentável, destrói o planeta. Então, porquê é que continuamos a insistir nessa tecla? Porquê é que continuamos a insistir no discurso verde? É só porque fica bem no discurso, como pergunta Gunter Pauli, chegou à altura então de perguntarmos, a economia azul não é a mesma coisa que a economia verde? Não, absolutamente não. Isto é a resposta de Gunter Pauli. E então, parto daqui para a conversa consigo para lhe perguntar porquê é que a economia azul não é a mesma coisa que a economia verde? Quais são as grandes diferenças?
Boa tarde.
Eu não sei se prefere falar.
Não, ia pôr a fazer a introdução no português.
I know you speak seven languages, so you choose English, Spanish, French.
We will start in English and you can ask in Portuguese.
Okay.
Is that okay? If you want to change, you can tell me. You know, when you look at the green economy, whatever is good for you and whatever is good for the environment is expensive. I mean, that is not a growth-driven economy. A growth-driven economy is, well, what is good for you and what is good for the environment is cheaper, and what is bad for the environment and bad for you is actually much more expensive. So we have it with the green economy upside down. And that is why I insisted with this particular experience, if we can put on the picture, please. When you see the picture, you will realize that on the screen comes up an orangutan. Can we have the orangutan? Yeah, there he is. This is a baby orangutan. The baby orangutan marked my life. Don't change, I'll change. The baby orangutan changed my life because I was the producer of the first factory in Europe that was making biodegradable soaps. I took on Procter & Gamble and Unilever to compete in the fast-moving consumer goods with a biodegradable soap. My factory was made out of wood, a wooden factory. I had the biggest grass roof on any building in Europe was my factory. It was my wastewater treatment plant because I pumped everything on the roof. In 1992, my fleet was running on biodiesel. 92. And in 1992, every worker coming to the job on a bicycle received half a euro a kilometer. I guarantee you, for half a euro per kilometer, people come on a bicycle. Because that's no cost. Still, I realized this. I went to Indonesia because it was the biggest buyer of palm oil. And the Indonesians told me, you're our hero. Kalimantan is in full development because of you. Until I realized that I was the guru in Europe and the guru in Indonesia, I was destroying the rainforest and the orangutan's habitat in Indonesia. And that changed my life. And so I started thinking, how come I have my MBA from INSEAD, right? I have my Jesuit education for 16 years. I should be able to foresee this, and I didn't. And then I realized this. In business, we have eliminated emotions. We make cool decisions. So I learned from the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences that when mankind first started to stand up, we took a big risk. Because standing up means we're running slower and we're not so stable. But we did it. Why? Because now we could carry food with us. And since we're carrying food with us, we have the opportunity to come home with food. And what happens when you come home with food and everyone is hungry? Daddy, we love you. And so the result is that we had a shift and we took the risk. The brain we have today has been growing for 60 million years, but the first growth is the emotional part. Then the motoric, then the intelligence. And 1 million years ago, our brain stopped developing. Interesting, huh? The brain we have today is the same size as the brain we had 1 million years ago. What happened? We started to develop ego. We became jealous. We became territorial. We started being busy with things that we shouldn't be busy with, and we lost the emotions out of our decision-making. We became rational. And that is why I show you this picture. What's so important about the sea otter hanging in the kelp? I'm a diver. I go deep-sea diving. But when I see in the kelp a sea otter, I nearly cry. This is beautiful. But what is the kelp? This is my son collecting kelp. Why kelp? Because it's the biggest carbon sequester we have in our world. Better than bamboo and anything else. But no one is farming kelp. So what is my reflection already 20 years ago? We will create the kelp industries. We will outcompete on the market with kelp. And people say, what do you know about kelp? Nothing. So why do you think you can do it? Because no one else knows. And I will be the first. And people say, that's impossible. You know what is my response when people tell me it's impossible? Please leave the room. and come back and ask me, how will it be possible? This is my son, the other son. I have six children. It means I look at the world through children. Because if we don't do that, then we're never going to get forward. And I am very fortunate that my organization I created after I sold all my business in 1994, that organization has benefited from many top mentors. Some of them you see here, you may know. As an economist who created 12 companies, two went bankrupt. As someone who created 12 companies, I know how to compete on the market, but I was always David versus Goliath. I took on the Goliaths, the big multinationals, and I won. Why do we win? Because we change the rules of the game without telling the big ones. You remember David versus Goliath? Who won? David. Why did he win? Because he wasn't going to go for a wrestling match. He decided he was going to throw some stones, and he didn't tell Goliath. That's what I'm doing. I don't tell what we're doing until it's on the market and it's done. Because the model of the core business, with a core competence, where we always look for marginal costs, increase productivity, eliminate labor, economies of scale, where we're outsourcing as much as we can, even out of the country, and we press everything into a supply chain management, where goods are delivered just in time, where we're building logistics and distribution centers, where cash is the king. Cash dominates, not profits, it's cash. We're going to leverage assets in order to be able to compete in a global market. Now, that's what we believed globalization will help us do. And what is the result? Today, massive youth unemployment, massive. We are forgetting that there are 400 million young people in Africa coming to the labor market in the next 20 years. Where do they think they want to go? Second, our communities are dying. Smaller cities die because everything gets sucked out of the economy with the logic of the economy of scale. And there's no exit from the poverty trap. Now, I am someone who in heart and soul is positive. I don't want to get negative. I want to look the challenges in the eye and say, what are we going to do? Now, this green economy is not going to do it. I call it blue. Now, if you don't want to call it blue because it's not the color of your soccer team or it's not the color of your political party, call it any color you want. The key is we got to do. And what we're doing is has to be highly innovative, disruptive. So disruptive that we think it is a complete new world. And I'll give you three cases later on. But it's disruptive because we changed the business model, not the technology. A fundamental shift in the business model is what we do. And we will be so competitive generating more value, we stop cutting costs. We have to stop cutting the costs. We have to start generate more value. In business, it's the value generation that drives you forward in the world economy, not the cutting of the costs. And this obsession, both at government level with these austerities and these obsessions with the business level, has to stop. And if they don't want to stop, that's fine, continue. I'm doing it the other way. I wrote this little book, The Blue Economy, which was a vision 6 years ago. And the vision was, as was announced, 100 innovations, 10 years, 100 million jobs. Last week, I presented in New Delhi the world premiere of my new book, Blue Economy version 2.0. That's the way we make it easy. 200 projects implemented, $4 billion invested, 3 million jobs generated. Let's look at this. We only use what we have. We focus on generating value. We increase buying power on the market, not salary increases. It's buying power that needs to be strengthened. And we secure that the cash is circulating much faster in the economy, speeding up velocity of cash. That means that we don't work with banks. If you work with banks, they sit on the cash for too long. We're disruptive. We say the way it is, we're for radical social and economic transformation. But at the same time, we're speeding up, we're scaling up, and we're out-competing. And guess what, ladies and gentlemen? We refuse subsidies. Every project that we have implemented is with zero subsidy, zero. No gifts from the European Union, no structural reforms money. We do it the way it should be done on the market. And we create portfolios of opportunities. Now, everything I do, and that has been successful, gets translated into a children's story. So this morning, I spent time with 60 children telling them fables. They're the same stories as I will tell you, just the language is slightly different. Let me give you about fishing. You have fishermen who are paid not to fish. I mean, have you ever heard something as stupid as that? So, we have today, with the government of Morocco, delivery of the first boats will come next October. We created a new fishing boat. Europe was not interested. Europe said we have to work about the quotas, Professor Pauli. You haven't been in Europe for a while, so you don't know that quota is the game. And I said, we don't want quotas. We're fishing without nets. That's the game changer. And people say, what? Fishing without nets? Yeah, and without hooks. How do you do that? Well, we do that the way the whales are doing it, and the way the dolphins are doing it, because dolphins and whales have been fishing for 1,000,000 years, and they never used a net. We have been fishing for 6,000 years, and we still use nets. We're a little bit behind. So when we see this, we created the mathematical models that teach us how an envelope of air is created around the sardines, all pelagic fishes, and how it is caught by dolphins in a very easy manner. But then we realize we have another very barbarian attitude, is that we kill the fish, including the mothers with eggs. Now, have you ever had anything that stupid? And we even pride ourselves of being able to afford to buy the eggs and eat it. You know that a sunfish, which is right in front of your Atlantic Ocean, nearly killed to death, fished to death, one sunfish, I think you call it Perche de Luna, the lure.
Lula.
That fish has 300 million eggs and you kill it? In normal cultures around the world, you should be put in jail for that. Because 300 million eggs, if you catch them and you kill them, then you have no fishes in the future. It's not about quota. So we designed a new catamaran. And this new catamaran doesn't have nets to pull. That means the torque is very different. And second, the catamaran will release bubbles underneath. Fish come up. We scoop them into the boat. And the boat will be 4 degrees water. 4 degrees water, the fish hibernates. The hibernating fish we put through an echographic system. Echographics, you remember, to know if it's a boy or a girl? We use the same technique. And every fish that is a female with eggs, back into the sea. What do you think happens? We've done the tests in El Hierro in Spain, in the Canary Islands. In 2 years, you're back at the fish level of 1956. Of course, you don't kill the females with eggs. Does it make sense? And now you don't need to have your compressors to create the ice. So our fishing boats work with solar energy and wind only. So we save 250,000 tons of petroleum a year per boat. We are so competitive, we outcompete with this boat that costs 3.4 million euro, the Chinese boats that come with a net for 600,000 euros. It's not the investment cost that's important, ladies and gentlemen. It's your capacity to generate revenue. Long term. That's what makes you competitive. We have an ROI on a boat that is more than that's more than 30%. People in the fishing industries have not seen an ROI of 30%, except when you're poaching in Indonesia. Second case. You know this flower? Cardo. You may get some enzymes out of it to make your cheese, but I think you don't do that anymore. You're all buying from Novozymes, genetically modified enzymes, so you can make cheese in high volume, same taste, same packaging, same everything. Welcome to Portugal and your wonderful cheeses made with Novozymes. Let's wake up. This is in Sardinia. I'm the chairman of this company, and this company looks at Sardinia and we see the bankrupt Eni Versalis cracker petrochemical facility. And we're asked, what can we do with this? And when I'm helicopter flying in, I see 70,000 hectares of fields of cardo. How come it grows? Very simple. The European Union paid them not to grow anything. Now, if the European Union pays not to grow anything, what do you have after 10, 20 years? Cardo. What is the cost of my raw material? I don't have to plant it. I don't have to fertilize it. I don't have to irrigate it. I don't need herbicides. I don't need pesticides. The only thing I need is a machine to harvest. Do you think that machine exists? Google. Distal harvesting machine. Or try this one. I need a distal chemist. Looking for chemists specialized in thistles, cardo. You don't find them, so we create them. Today, we're the big partners of Slow Food. You know Slow Food, yes? We're partners of Slow Food. And out of the thistle, we create polymers, capsules for lavazza, herbicides, which is the natural herbicide we extract, elastomers to mix with rubber, and the lubricant agents. And then we have a waste left over, and that waste is animal feed. Animal feed. We can supply animal feed at 250 euro a ton, whereas the Europeans are importing soy from Brazil at 600. And I'm gonna sell it for 250, why? Because I need more manure on the land, because if I start harvesting on the land, I need fertilizer on the land, and therefore, if the cost of feed for the animals is half, then the farmer will double the amount of cows or goats. It's as simple as that. I mean, this is very simple arithmetic. A farmer doesn't need to go more complex. So the result is that now we have the enzymes to make the cheese. We have 2,000 tons of enzymes, which is enough enzymes for the whole of Sardinia. And so we outcompete Novozyme on price, quality, locality, culture, biodiversity, everything. This is the facility we took over. The facility in Sardinia is a cracker installation, a petrochemical, which today is a biorefinery. We're going for 360,000 tons. Why? Very simple. All the fields combined in Sardinia gives us 360,000 tons of cardo. That's our business model. It's sustained, it's renewable, and what is my cost price? It's embarrassingly low. It is lower than shale gas, it's lower than petroleum, it is lower than genetically modified crops, it's lower than anything, because what? It's there. I use what we have. This is the facility that was inaugurated. This is our facilities. Today, ladies and gentlemen, thanks, amongst others, to the support of Matteo Renzi, the Prime Minister, we have already 6 petrochemical facilities taken out and converted them to biorefineries. You don't read that in the media in Portugal. You don't read that in the European Union's messages either. We just do it, and we don't have press officers. We're sick and tired of telling people what we do. We do. And to us, this is the key. Next case. And you just tell me when I have to stop, because
no, it's okay.
I got 200 cases.
No, it's okay.
If you want to go through all 300, I'm happy, but you know, we have to make a deal on lunch. This is the project we implemented in Spain, El Cabildo, El Hierro. Who's been to the Canary Islands? I know you got beautiful beaches yourself. You don't have to go to Spain. You can stay here. You have the Azores. I can do the same with your Azores, if you ever wanted to. This is the beauty of the island. It only has one big problem. Well, five problems. First of all, no water. Second, no energy. Third, no jobs. Fourth, no mobility. Five, dependent on subsidies. Now, if an island depends on subsidies, what comes in? Corruption. Of course. Political friendships will prevail. And therefore, we said we're going to initiate a program that has been implemented. It was inaugurated last year. We turned the island self-sufficient in water and power. Now, what's the result? We have an 11.5 megawatt wind park and hydropower. That means we first have the wind, we supply to the grid, the excess power, we pump water 700 meters up, we don't use batteries, as you said, we don't use batteries, we use flywheels as a backup. You remember flywheels? Leonardo da Vinci, he made these flywheels that just keep on turning and actually you build up your energy on a flywheel instead of a battery. And people say, why don't you want a battery? Because, ladies and gentlemen, I'm next to the coast. If I'm next to the coast, it's too salty. And if it's too salty, then my battery's life will be half a year of what they say on the paper. And that will increase my cost, and I want to have more value. So, we have the system installed. It's invested. And of course, people tell me, Professor Pauli, did you really get an MBA? Because the cost is 83 million euro. I mean, this is a white elephant. Come on, Professor Pauli, start admitting that this is a white elephant. 10,500 people, 83 million euro, it's out of proportion. Well, no, it's not out of proportion. Why? Because yes, it's a capex of 83 million, but the people are spending today 8 million euro per year on the importation of petroleum. Now, can we do the calculation on the back of the envelope? 8 million a year multiplied by 10 is 80 million. I can give a 10% return on the condition that the local population guarantees me they will not buy petroleum anymore. You think that's difficult? And for 10 years in return, the population will pay electricity rates that are exactly the same as before. You think people would like that? 10 years lock-in of electricity prices in return for a guarantee of the 8 million that they were spending anyway. And the result is that the government of Spain, which has the habit of subsidizing too much, the subsidy for bringing the petroleum to the island for 10 years is capitalized, and the government got 10% of the project. Capitalization of subsidies, ladies and gentlemen. What is the result? We have double the amount of water at half the cost. Renewable, 100%. The whole agriculture is turning agriculture because they never had any chance to do anything else. And we restart industries. When you now have first the wind used to supply the grid, second, to pump up the water, third, the marginal cost electricity is used to do reverse osmosis. That means we have reverse osmosis at 1 cent kilowatt hour. No one has that. Unless you generate multiple cash flows. Now we have doubled the water at half the cost. What is the result? The yogurt factory opens. The cheese factory opens. The slaughterhouse reopens. And we were told we couldn't compete. Well, we can compete because we have something next to us. It's called Tenerife. And I guarantee you, those Germans are happy, very happy to have fresh yogurt from the island instead of the yogurt they fly in from Germany. We have too much electricity, we have so energy efficiency that now we can offer the fleet of electric cars for free. Next case. Are you okay? If you want to go into detail, you have the right to do that. But I want to give you a flavor of the financials that are behind it. I want to give you a flavor of the innovation. Have I talked about impossible high-tech things? Did I need a CERN and a plasma technology and 3D printing and all of that? No. But we're changing the business models to the point that we have one great advantage. The island of El Hierro is the island today in Spain, the city in Spain, with the lowest unemployment rate of Spain. That's my pride. The lowest unemployment rate. La Caixa co-invested. Endesa is our technical partner. We go with big and we go with small, but we want results on the ground. Savings in water. One of the great problems is water. Now, here you see a mine. Mines generate a lot of rock wastes. And that waste is going to contaminate the air and the soil for centuries to come. Well, we looked at it, and we started producing something else. We make paper out of this. 5 years ago, we had a 12,000-ton facility to make paper from rocks. People said, that's not possible. Well, yeah, if you're in the paper business, that's not possible. But if you're in my way of thinking in business, it's very possible. What's the cost of the rock waste? Zero. We get paid to take it away. Have you heard of that before? You want to create a competitive industry against the paper sector, which is in crisis today? We're turning the business model around. Europe, no one wanted to come along. Latin America, no one wanted to come along. I sat 1 hour with the Chinese Director General of the Ministry of Industry and Energy and explained to him, we make paper without a tree, without water, with 60% less energy. And the ministers and the Director General says, where? In Taiwan. He said, oh, let's go. He saw it. He said, we'll do it. What do you need in Europe now if you want to do that? Feasibility studies. Technology audits, commissions to decide, experts to give opinion. You got to hire a lot of people just to go all give an opinion so you make certain that the lobbies could enter so it will never take off. That's what Europe is. That's why I don't work in Europe except for a few projects. We have to cut through this game. If you want jobs and you want an economy of the future, you as entrepreneurs have the responsibility to cut through the game. It's not the government's responsibility. Entrepreneurs, we have to do that. So what do? Well, we make paper from stone. There is my fable with a macaco who's crushing the rocks. That's the symbol of Taiwan. We were 5 years ago at 12,000 tons, ladies and gentlemen. Today, this year, we're hitting 1 million tons. Chinese government has decided we're going to go for 25% of the market. In China, that is 25 million tons. That means $25 billion investment. You know what China is saving? The water. If China were to maintain its growth rates, it had, water consumption would rise so fast that they would have to build another Three Gorges Dam. They've saved a Three Gorges Dam, which costs $15 billion. Now, that kind of integrated thinking, unfortunately, we don't have in Europe. In China or in India, we have it. So we mobilize the capital, we implement and focus. And then I have strange partners like ExxonMobil. I never thought they would become my partner. I thought they always thought I was the green guy, you know? So ExxonMobil has changed all its paper in the field for stone paper. Why? Can be recycled indefinitely, doesn't use water, and we're in the field and it's dirty, you can wash it without taking off what you've written. Interesting. And when you finish with your folder, you will not shred it, because now we know that the CIA can still find the stripes, what was written there. Yeah. We recycle it back into paper and you can't read anything. They like that. We make magazines. Ladies and gentlemen, do you think there's a future for the paper industry, the magazine industry? In China, anyone who has a subscription with a stone paper as a base will get 50% of the pay the subscription for the magazine back if at the end of the year they bring the magazines back to the company. Technically, what does it mean? Technically, we have changed the cost of paper into an asset that goes on the balance sheet. You want to look at the printing shop again? You want to look at publishing again when you can eliminate all your paper or 50% of your paper and you put it on your balance sheet? You are out-competing those digi guys. You can do digitally what no one has ever, you can do with paper what digitally is not possible anymore. You changed your cost. That was the first factory we put up, the first one. These are the machineries. Yes, we use a little bit of water to cool, but that's a closed cycle. We have changed the size of the machinery. It's a complete new thinking of machinery. You can order your paper and your paper is made to order within 2 weeks. Can't do that today. We've eliminated the warehousing, the logistics, the special machines. We're 1/3 of the capital costs. And I had never experienced in paper in my whole life. Well, that's probably why I could think it up. Because if I had experience, I would not be able to do it. We need to get out of the box. Industry, business, we need to get out of the box. Now, I don't know if you want to hear this one. 3 minutes, yes. Or 3 minutes over time already.
No, yeah. Over time, 3 minutes, now, and more 3 minutes.
May I have 6 children, so this is a very dear project for me. It's about diapers, you know, for the babies. Yeah. There are 109,000 babies in Berlin who are all using Pampers. And what are we doing with this? Well, there it is. No, we don't wash them. We actually eliminate, our plan is to eliminate 125,000 trucks we need every year in Berlin to carry that to the landfill. Every baby produces 3,000 liters of diaper plus, excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, pee-pee and poo-poo. That's being produced. And what do we do with it? We turn it into terra preta. You know terra preta? We turn into terra preta. What do we do with the terra preta? That's enough for 1,000 fruit trees. So we have the business model to give the diapers for free to the mamas. For free. They're 100% biodegradable. But the mamas organize Tupperware-like sales of the fruit trees. By selling the fruit trees for €5 a tree, you're generating €10,000 of revenue. That means with 100 families, you have €1 million. €1 million to do what? To eliminate the diaper from the waste cycles, first. To generate trees and fruit trees around your city you have never been able to put on the budget of any city. And to give what? Fruits to the people. 1,000 trees per baby per year. Do you realize how many trees that is in 20, 25 years? How would your city look like when this were to be actively promoted? The mayor of Berlin has decided to go. Herr Oberbürgermeister Müller has decided this is the way to go. And this is what we need to do. We need to rethink our logic, because now the trees will provide the fresh fruits for the babies. Why do we want to import fruits from Chile to give to our babies? We just have to get the fruit trees. And here is the first planting campaign in Berlin we have. You can go to Berlin. We have space in Berlin to do 1 billion fruit trees in Berlin. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know if you sense it, but it's fun to innovate. I don't think that Procter & Gamble loves this proposal. They're thinking this is a high growth, high margin, high cash. They see it as a star in their good old Boston consulting model. And we're saying it's going to be your dog. It's over. The game is over because, not because you're bad, the game is over because we know we can do much better. And this is a bottom-up initiative where in our market study in Berlin has shown that 100% of the mothers is in favor. 100%. The statisticians say there must be an error there. You can't have 100%. Now, I'm not going to present this. I'm only going to present the very end of this, the last picture. No, this one. In Colombia, we have regenerated the forests in an area where only refugees from the drugs were living. The forest gives you water, and everyone in the area where we work at the age of 6 will get a bicycle for free. What do you think happens when you drink 3 liters of water a day and you ride the bicycle? You're very healthy. As a result, the hospital we built had to be closed due to lack of patients. This is transformation of the economy and the social reality of the community. We've done this. We can do it again. And so can you. To conclude, if we only teach our children what we know, our children will never be able to do better than us. I was a rebel. I don't know if my Jesuit priests liked me that much. I was a nuisance very often, I'm sure. I had to come to class after class to be disciplined. And sometimes some people feel that I should be disciplined again. But I know that with the fables, the stories, the reality that we have today, we're transforming the economy. It is much more environmental, much more social than we ever imagined. Today, my Chinese partners have published all these fables with me. But what is key is that you, with the challenges you have in Portugal, you have to set yourself targets that are way beyond what is being said by the European Union, and definitely by Mr. Barroso. We've got to go beyond the cutting of the budgets and the saving of the costs. We have to define the strategies to do it and be inspired by cases that work. And then you have to inspire the children. Because when the children come on board, everything is possible. Mandela said, "It always seems impossible until it's done." Indeed. I have to admit to you that where I am today with the projects we've implemented, it's way beyond than I thought was possible even just 5 years ago. That means the market, the people, the financing, the policymakers, people are ready for the shift. So help me tip it over. Thank you.